We were at the record plant in New York City, and it was just myself and a couple of other guys in the band I was in. Freddie Smith played tenor, Larry Fawcett played conga, and Buddy Miles. And that was, it was just us and Jimmy, and we kind of discussed what we were going to do, he had a little sketch, and you know, of what he wanted, and we actually just jammed. We did a couple of false starts because there was a certain couple of parts of it that he wanted specifically that we kind of worked out in advance that were kind of like, you know, signposts on the road to jamdom, and you know, we kind of got off track at first at a couple of attempts, and then just kind of recorded one long piece, and which he carved into two songs after he wrote lyrics and so on. Yeah, it was not, there was nothing wild about it. It was like very calm and cool. Nobody was toe up or, you know, it was just, we just a couple hours of having a good time. He communicated it just like guys do, you know. He said, we're gonna do this in D. And he said, I mean, what he had said to me and the other cats was, I mean, he heard us recording that day earlier, or a couple days. We'd been in there for several days working on our own album, and he'd heard us playing. So he, you know, the way he knew how we played. I played organ, Hammond organ, played organ bass, foot pedals, and left hand bass, and that was the sound he was looking for on this particular track, because he said, you know, it's like his description before we started tracking was, you know, it's kind of like a Jimmy Smith shuffle kind of thing, like back at the Chicken Shack or one of those kinds of, you know, organ trio kind of albums, except he goes, I'm going to be the guitar player. Yeah, well, that term shamming is, you know, I mean, I've been a musician for 50 years. I knew Buddy Miles when he was messing his britches. You know, he's from Omaha. I mean, I was a little older than Buddy. He was a child prodigy, or what Etta James used to call a child protege. You know, but I was just playing a walking bass line. There was no walking. What I actually played, as I mentioned in my last answer, was the same bass line that Jimmy Smith plays on back at the Chicken Shack, which is a 5-1 thing. And that's, you know, there's some other, a few other things, a few variations, but that was the basis. I played left-hand bass and organ bass, which is, you know, in the band I was playing in, I was the bass player. You know, at the time, I was playing Hammond organ, which, you know, also includes bass pedals. And, although you don't get to do that much in that band. That was a little unusual even in those days, because it was a rhythm and blues band, and with, you know, trumpet and tenor and percussion and drums and guitar and organ. And so, you know, I think that was one of the reason that happened is, as I said, Jimmy was coming in the evening. He heard us recording. When he'd arrive, we'd be finishing up. And he noticed that was how we played. And so that was, he, you know, I think that's what gave him the idea, like, hey, these guys got this thing going on. Let's see what happens, you know, as opposed to a regular bass player. Let's play Jimi Hendrix with an organ trio and see what jumps off, you know.
Again, how did that build on the structure of the song? And would you say that Jimmy's approach was like a jazz leader?
Yes, it was. He was, as I mentioned earlier in my prior answers for slow learners. There was a jazz approach going on. I mean, that was definitely what he was going for, something that, you know, as he talks about, you know, the lyrics are brilliant because, you know, even like including the, you know, he took a hit. You know, but lay back and groove on a rainy day. And, you know, that easygoing thing,
yeah,
that vibe of, was definitely kind of the antithesis of so much of what he had done in the past and what he was identified with as a as an artist. You know, the antithesis, I say, because, you know, he's identified with this fiery, you know, like, you know, in your face, you know, crazy, of course, you know, totally innovative and totally different approach than many people had, but essentially a blues-based player, but also with the inventiveness of a jazz musician. The blues and jazz it's all the same, but he was a great innovator and a great improviser and had real command of his instrument and stretched out the way people were playing. But on that, you know, like, he starts, like, with that, everything that he played on it, there was a very much a jazz influence. Echoed his, like, in other words, we were having a little conversation in different parts of the tune. That was not directed. That happened, you know. Hustle's the wind.